You're listening to Griffin Radio, Grossmont College, El Cajon, California.
It's big, it's beautiful, and you're going to love it.
Welcome to Get This, the thinking man's analysis of people chasing airplanes, naked ATV drivers, fast food rage, and all the other hard-hitting stories cable news doesn't want you to hear.
Hold on to your butts.
Ladies and gentlemen, get this.
That's right. Welcome to Get This on Griffin Radio. We are GR.
Yay.
We're here every Tuesday and Thursday from noon to one. I'm your host, DJ Lunchbox.
And I am DJ B. Millie. That's me.
And we are sans supremus at the moment, but he will be joining us shortly. Texted me, let me know he was on his way.
Yeah.
Running a little late, and so we will have the joy of supremus later on today.
Oh, yay.
The views, comments, and opinions expressed on the show are those of individuals and not necessarily shared by Griffin Radio, the Media Communications Department, Grossmont College, or the Grossmont Cuyamaca Community College District. This podcast is copywritten by Griffin Radio and Grossmont College 2019. Thank you very much. Oh, my God, did we have fun playing Hotel Never Rest yesterday.
Yeah, it was really fun.
For anybody who might have listened to us yesterday, thank you so much for joining us. It's a game that Remus, Supremus, B-Millie, myself, and DJ Noob have been playing. Mm-hmm. It's a game, a D&D-style game that Supremus has set up where we're in a haunted hotel, and oh my God, are we having a good time. I love it.
It really is a lot of fun.
I look forward to doing that show with you guys just as much as I do coming in to do my own show.
Oh, wow.
It's just, I love stories. I love that kind of episodic adventuring.
It is really fun.
I love putting curses on bellboys.
You know? Oh, that was so funny. I'm so glad I helped you with that.
Me too.
I'm so glad that that's what I helped
that
with.
That was teamwork.
So funny.
Par excellence right there.
Just to give him a horrible, horrible disease.
What did I give him? It was...
You said you remember the cruise?
I was like, that's right. I gave him the norovirus.
Yes.
So he's going to be leaking. There's going to be a little leakage going on there. So we're going to play, surprise, surprise, Did This Happen to Me? Because it's not Thursday without a little game from B-Millie.
It's me.
And we'll do a little recap about what that is when we actually get to it.
Yes.
First of all, I want to do a few announcements, though.
Mm-hmm.
As you are well aware of by now, or should be anyway, Griffin Radio is a proud part of the Grossmont College community, and we're always looking to highlight news and information about clubs and events that our fellow students and faculty should know about. So if you have any news or announcements you'd like us to mention on air, please bring any ASGC-approved flyers to Griffin Radio down here in Building 20, Room 205, or you can email us at griffinradiostation@yahoo.com. That is griffinradiostation@yahoo.com. There's too much going on around on campus in El Cajon in this area. We really want to make sure that if you have something worthwhile, that you have something you really would like a little community support for, mm-hmm. please let us know. We're more than happy to get it out there and spread the word. That's what we're here for.
More than happy. We love hearing what's going on in the community, and especially we love hearing what's going on campus. Because we do a lot of remotes, but we don't get to do all of them. So we'll pass by events that we can't play music for, and we just want to know everything about them and what's going on with them.
And speaking of, we actually have another live remote coming up next Wednesday.
Yes.
And then we have one the following week on Tuesday. So we will be out and about. Please feel free to come by our tables. I mean, I know that we look kind of pale and unapproachable and kind of like the Addams Family sitting over there under our green tent, but come say hi. We won't bite.
I was going to
There he is.
I was going to go in a completely different direction for that. I was going to say, I know we're very intimidatingly attractive and, you know, like nothing you've ever seen before, but please come up
to us.
Well,
don't confuse people. They won't know who they're looking for if you tell them to look for all the hot... you tell them to look for the hot group, they'll be like, oh, I don't know, I just see those radio nerds over there.
It's our boy. What's up, my guy?
Hey, Supremus.
Not much.
Welcome back.
How's it going?
I'm glad you were able to get in here with us.
What?
My duid?
My dude? Oh.
My dude.
Chilling.
My quid.
Chilling. Let's see. So I wanted to mention Gizmo's Kitchen here.
Yes.
Gizmo's Kitchen, in partnership with the San Diego Food Bank, provides food assistance to any currently enrolled Grossmont College student experiencing inconsistent access to adequate food. The program provides short-term relief and offers referrals for additional community food resources for ongoing assistance with food insecurity. 67% of community college students experience food insecurity around here. Do you not hear the gravity of the announcement I'm making right now, Sam? I mean, come on.
The nerve.
He's
of
doing
some
like
people.
His best Patrick Starr impression
the
over there.
The nerve of some people.
He didn't have a star on his hat.
I know. I kept thinking Steven Universe all morning.
Oh.
It was glaring at me. Gizmo's Kitchen offers food pantry services which are confidential and may be accessed once a week with your valid Grossmont College student ID when regular classes are in session, which is now, inside the Student Health Services building, which is building 60, room 130, during the following hours, Monday through Thursday from 10 a.m. to 2, so they are open right now if you happen to need any assistance. They are closed on Friday, but if you need assistance outside those hours, please call 211 for resources near you. 67% of college students experience food insecurity, which means if you're in there of a class of 30, there are 20 people around you who don't know when their next meal is going to be or if they've even eaten today or yesterday. That's a hard thing to think about.
It's a lot of people, too.
So please, please help with Gizmo's Kitchen. It's an incredibly worthwhile program they have set up here at Grossmont. So if you have any approved shopping items, the approved list from the shopping items that you'd like to bring by, once again, building 60, room 206 in the Common Grounds. If you have any questions, please feel free to contact Susan.Berry, B-E-R-R-Y, Susan.Berry@gcccd.edu for more information. Gentlemen, would you like to pick something to let us know about?
Do you want to go next?
Sure. Let's see.
Go for it.
What do we got, guys?
We got
get it going.
Duff.
We got some stuff.
All right. The 2019 Females in Film Festival is open for submissions until April 26th. Entries must have at least one woman in a major production role, including scriptwriter, art director, producer, or director. Films must be no more than 10 minutes. For more information, check the FIF Snapchat at Females in Film SD or email the festival at fif.festivalsd@gmail.com. Cool stuff.
I'm in the television studio class right now.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of women in the class that are really excited about getting some submissions together for this Females in Film Festival.
Oh, yeah.
It's love amazing. It. And there's flyers all over the place for it. It's a really cool event.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And the Campus Life short film is actually going to be for the females.
Oh, awesome.
Film.
Very cool.
Even better. You got one, okay. B-Millie?
Yeah, I got one. Because we said we'd talk about it, and because we said we would promote it, my announcement is about the Media Communications Department here at Grossmont College, the department that we are all in, and most of us are majoring in. We are majoring in Media Communications. Now, communications and media communications here at Grossmont College are two separate things. Our media communications building is so incredible and so unknown because there's this big Smurf-like wall that is blocking off almost the entirety of the building from the construction. If you go by the construction and see where that construction is, that building that's being blocked by that giant tidal wave of blue walls, that is our building. Come inside. It is so impressive and so amazing the work we do in this department. If you want to sign up for the radio class that we are in right now, sign up for MCOM 119A next semester.
Do it.
MCOM 119A. That is your starting semester. It works in terms of A, B, and C as you progress through the semesters. But if you want to come in, have a great time, have some specialty shows, get on the air, and do all that good stuff, sign up. It is worth your while, I promise.
Absolutely.
You know, and it's funny you mention that because we just happen to have a little audio promo here that really highlights what we do.
Oh, yes, we do.
In the MCOM 119 program. Here at Griffin Radio, we're always looking for new voices to join these discussions where we cover a wide range of topics that you, our valued listeners, want to hear.
Away from me, Satan!
I can't look at you anymore.
The Uranus Examiner.
I can see DJ Supreme is going to jail for this.
Get off my lawn!
Shove so many in your mouth, they're all just gonna spill out of your mouth.
If I saw clowns inside or outside my home, they can have it.
You don't have to be a genius to know that that's a dumb idea.
I vomited instantly.
I'm not sure if I'm divorced or not.
I love it, man.
Take MCOM 119 next semester to join Griffin Radio, and you too can be a part of these dazzling conversations.
So yeah, that's just a little bit of what, just a smidgen of what we have to offer here in the media communications program.
I mean, if anyone listens to our show, they know very well. Yep. It's just a smidge.
Just a smidge.
Just a taste.
We have our weird news roundtable that we do here. We have sports programs. Yep. We have people doing music reviews. I mean, we've like video game news, industry news. I mean, we've got all kinds of interesting stuff, and that's just a little bit.
I say this a lot about a lot of things, but I legitimately, not joking, think I could do like a 6-hour segment on the media communications department alone.
Honestly, though.
Well, we'll serialize that. We'll make sure you've got, like, who was the guy who used to do the old biography? You're listening to biography. And then they play the little music, and then they do
the...
Okay.
Idea.
Never mind that. I am just, once again, showing my age.
But yeah, so, media communications department. It's great.
Yeah.
Yes.
So I know we are definitely going to play a little round of Did This Happen to Me?
Yes.
With B. Millie today.
Yes. Yeah.
And, but I did want to kind of stop a little bit because today's kind of a big day, big happenings. I wanted to change it up. Big happenings, yeah. I wanted to change it up a little bit and spend some time on the show today talking about some of the legal and political ramifications of the Attorney General's press conference today about the Mueller report.
Okay.
And really how it's going to... No, I just... I'm screwed.
I had a feeling. I was like, there's no way.
You had me on my serious face.
I know. You looked terrified.
I was like, oh my goodness. This
why
is
am
actually...
I here?
No, not why am I here. I was like, Justin... Is this actually like affecting you right now? Let's take this time
hell
to talk
no.
about this.
Oh hell no. No.
It's
no.
Justin, why would it be affecting him?
Yeah, I'm just too calloused over. I don't feel things
that's
anymore.
So funny.
Bemilly, you ready to play?
I could not be more ready to play. And
I'm
also
so
introduce the new intro that I made for this show.
Please.
Hello, my name is Bemilly.
Da-da.
Yeah, you know that is me.
That's me!
I'm gonna ask you questions 3, and we will have to see. Did this happen to me?
Did it happen to me?
Did you really make a promo for you, an intro for yourself that you could start doing in rounds with yourself?
I don't think you understand how much that completed my life.
See, I
told... Oh my god.
Supremus, I told you you'd feel better once you got here.
Oh my god, it's
that
so
even...
good.
Oh my god.
It was to the Animaniacs.
I know, and I love it.
I swear to god.
I'm gonna cry. That was the best thing I've ever heard in my life.
It is so good.
So this game that we play every Thursday is a game that B. Millie's brought into us, and he reads us 3 scenarios. And Supremus and I have to guess whether this was something that actually happened in B. Millie's own life or it's something that he found on Reddit. Mm-hmm. So with that, and by the way, I believe Supremus, my sir, that you are undefeated in this.
Mm-hmm. Potentially.
I believe you are undefeated. So with
even
that,
when I'm not here.
Okay.
Yeah, even when you're not here.
Are we ready?
Oh, we're doing this.
Oh yeah, here we go.
Let's go.
Round 1.
Okay.
Fight.
When I was a child, a substitute teacher came to our class, and we... Where did it just go? When I was a child, a substitute teacher came to our class, and we had to write letters apologizing because we're being bad. I did not know how to spell that professor's last name, so he told me, just put down Mr. Gary, as my last name is too hard. So I wrote him a letter that said, to Mr. Gary too hard.
Oh no. I mean,
he's an analyst and a therapist. He's an analrypist.
Ooh. I'm gonna say that's not you.
Not me.
I'm gonna say that's just so damn cute. I'm gonna say that was you.
That was not me.
Okay.
That was a modified version of a story from Sergeant Gary, who did that in his, he did that to his sergeant. So he wrote a letter to his sergeant and called him Sergeant Gary Too Hard.
Wow.
That's amazing.
It's just, wow.
Okay.
All right.
Next one. My sister didn't do so well on her driver's ed test. It might have had something to do with how she completed the sentence that made her fail the test. When the blank is dead, the car won't start. And she wrote, when the driver is dead, the car won't start.
I mean, that. How is that a wrong answer?
Right? I don't understand how
Did
that's a wrong answer.
Did this happen to my sister?
But I'm going to say yes.
I say yes, too.
It did not happen to my sister. It happened to Nathan Hellman's sister from Brooklyn, New York.
Wow, they got strict driving laws over there.
Apparently. You even when you're dead, you still have to be able to start the car.
You have to be licensed and alive. What kind of draconian rules do they have over there? That's unreasonable.
And the last one. Recently, I actively believe that somebody was stalking me and trying to kill me because at first my tire popped, looked like it was slashed. Then I had put gas in that same car. The next day, I went back and the tank was completely on empty as if somebody had siphoned my gas. I then learned that I had put gas in a completely different car and I was paranoid for no reason.
For some reason, this sounds really familiar to me. I'm going to stick to my guns again and say this happened to you.
I'm also going to say it happened to you.
This did happen to me. I actively believe that somebody was trying to kill me because they slashed my tire and siphoned my gas. I did not want to drive my car because I thought the brakes would not work. And then I found out that I had put gas in a completely different car, and the reason my car's tires look slashed is because a raccoon came and...
Amazing. Okay, but how did you manage to put gas in a different
car? That's the question I have.
I just forgot. I used my family's car, and I forgot that I put it in a different car.
Okay, that makes sense.
So you didn't just somehow find yourself in a different car? Okay.
No. I had driven the family car the day before and put gas in that car, then went back to my own personal car, found out that the tank was on empty, and was extremely confused and scared.
Yeah, I would say so. All right, well, once again, Remus, congratulations.
Yeah.
You are today's winner. And, that's enough of that. Okay, I'm tired of your little smug dance over
that
there.
That was Did This Happen to Me?
That's my
horrible,
cute dance. It's not my smug dance.
Horrible intro.
It's smug to
singing.
Me, and it is now.
Trust me, if I was being smug, you would know it.
You have kicked my ass every week consecutively.
That was Did This Happen to Me with my horrible singing intro, of which I cannot sing and never will be able to.
I think we could play around with it a little bit.
That
I think
really
we could,
cute,
yeah, make, it,
could
make it pretty it. Fun.
Yes, and to answer your question, Justin, that is exactly why I did Animaniacs.
I love Animaniacs.
Because I wanted to come in here and do rounds with my own song as it was playing.
I'm literally, that's like the greatest thing I've ever heard.
We struck some kind of vein in you yesterday. You've just been going like this ever
since. Oh my gosh. I don't know what happened with me yesterday, but I went to, we went to get coffee, and there must have been something Betty must have put something extra into our coffee yesterday, because
honestly,
I came back to the station.
And it wasn't love.
And did three promos, three liners, worked on my audio project, and I did a project with Steven as well.
Dang. I think she put a little crack in your mocha.
I don't know what she
I
put
think
in
so
there,
too.
But I think I might have to go back and get some more. Not just because Betty
absolutely.
Is the best. Not just because Betty is the best.
Betty down there at the at the Pete's coffee desk.
If you don't know Betty,
we love
you
Betty.
Should know Betty.
Betty's awesome.
Betty is the best.
Get drinks from Betty.
Betty is the bestie.
Tip Betty.
Tip Betty.
Betty needs a little tippage.
Oh,
and
yeah.
If you can tell Betty's having a rough day, just order your coffee and move through the line, you know?
Defo.
We don't have 8 hours for you to find the creamer half and half that you could have just lived without, you know?
Amen to that.
You know?
Absolutely.
That girl's working hard down there. Just move along. Order your coffee, leave her a fiver, and get the hell out of line.
Don't be that person that goes to the Starbucks expecting them to make a decaf cafe mocha with, like, extra low-fat milk and then also add 18 different things to the line. You know?
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Just order your drink.
Leave the poor
out.
Girl alone, for God's sake.
Goodness. We love you, Betty. We love you, Betty.
Love
yes,
you, Betty.
Yes, we do.
We should probably tell her we're actually doing this at some point, because she has no speaker.
Oh, no. Yeah.
All right, let's do some news.
Yes.
Two of you posing like over there.
And then getting ready with that stack of papers with the Sirius.
I feel like I'm on Anchorman. Because you are wearing a little bit of a burgundy shirt over there, I should point out.
Yes.
Oh, amazing.
Yes. Ron Burgundy.
Two parents tried a dine-and-dash from their restaurant bill, but forgot to bring their child with them. Just can't stay.
I would react more to the fact that parents left their child in a store to the dine and dash, but this song is so good. I just had to like soak it in for a second.
Did you hear that bass coming through the headphones there? The man and woman were dining at a restaurant with their 10-year-old daughter. They ordered drinks and had a meal, which ran up to $135.
Oh, wow.
That's a lot of drinks. One of the evidently decided not to pay. The couple plotted with each other to leave the restaurant without paying for their meal, so they ran out of the building, but they didn't tell their daughter to run with them. So the girl stayed in the restaurant until the police arrived. The police found the intoxicated couple a short distance away from the restaurant and were subsequently arrested. They were taken into custody while the poor abandoned child was taken to Child and Family Services.
Yeah.
This is why it's so important to communicate over meals. This is why dinner is such an important meal in the day. This is when families get a chance to sit down and talk about their days.
And talk
what's
about,
in their lives.
Oh my talk God. About their plans to run from
That's so
this,
funny.
The store. Restaurant.
Yeah, so when you're sitting there having dinner, and you're a 10-year-old child, and you hear your parents go, 1, 2, 3, and then they run, you should probably tell your 10-year-old that you're going to be splitting on the bill so that they know to come with you.
Yeah, it'd be a good idea to get in on it. Oh my gosh. God. It's like, how are you so drunk that you forget to tell your child to run out?
It's sad enough when people do forget their own child sitting there doing whatever it is they're doing. You know, I have to say, I've loved this semester how many times, I think that's the third time we've gotten an instructor to simply stop and stare at us while they're walking through the room.
Yeah. True.
For those of you, which is everybody, that can't see right now, Dr. Wierig just came through and stopped and stared at us while we explained the
it's
amazingness
my favorite
of this
part,
story.
My absolute favorite part is not just when they come and stop, but when they walk through and then they double back.
Oh, yeah.
And then they kind of stare at
That's
us from around
the
wall
best.
Like, wait a minute, what?
Callow does it a lot.
She does that a couple of times and her mouth has kind of dropped open and she's just, what are you guys talking about in here?
The stuff that needs to be talked about, Callow. We talk about
news.
These hard-hitting stories.
As the journalism instructor,
there you
I
go.
Mean, she should be all up in
she
this.
She should understand.
A mother and her boyfriend reported the disappearance of her daughter and blamed it on the daughter's father in order to get back at him. This is some hard-hitting criminality right here.
I was going to say, I see us also doing series posts to this, and then the screen fades to blue for me. And then red to Justin.
No. We'll be black and white, but there'll be like a blue stripe across our
Ooh,
legs
okay,
that,
there we
move,
go.
That just kind of moves across the screen.
Oh my goodness!
And Supremus will be in her in his judge outfit, in his judge robes,
yeah,
with the gavel.
Oh my goodness!
Me and Lunchbox will be me and Lunchbox will be law, and you will be order.
Yes.
Oh
law,
my
order.
God, that's a great idea.
I will
like Rizzoli and Isles
judge.
Will be law and order. Oh my God! I love it.
Why do we have so many ideas, y'all?
Why are we not writing these down?
I wrote one of our ideas down.
Literally Lunchbox frantically looking for something to write with. It's exact.
Siobhan Vaughn, yes, that is her name.
Ooh.
Siobhan Vaughn and
I
her
like
boyfriend,
that.
Antoine Holiday from Sacramento, devised a plan to enact revenge on her daughter's father by framing him of kidnapping his own daughter. So it's the woman and her boyfriend trying to frame the father of this woman's daughter.
Okay.
The police were contacted and received reports of a missing 10-year-old girl. The report stated that the girl had gone missing on Tuesday morning after her grandfather dropped her off at her dad's house. Siobhan told the police that the father was hiding her daughter, but the police treated the situation as a missing child case due to the severity of the situation. Sergeant Bryce Heinlein of the Sacramento Police told KFBK News Radio, "We treated this incident where the child was missing and potentially at risk. The amount of time that goes into something like this can be very frustrating and dangerous." And here's where the fun part kicks in.
Oh, boy.
The police investigated all parties of the missing child by interviewing them, and they concluded that the mother, Siobhan, was lying about the hiding of the child. The police searched all the homes of the friends and family involved and found the 10-year-old girl safe at the boyfriend's house. So she just simply was pissed off at her baby daddy and decided to call the police about this. And apparently she was simply surprised that the cops decided to investigate the missing child.
Why would you investigate that? Wouldn't you just take my word for it and go arrest my ex-husband?
Yeah. So the mother and the boyfriend were both arrested and charged with reporting a false emergency, delaying police, and conspiracy. And the little girl was just, she was perfectly fine. You know, the police came and found her and she was like, "Hi, what? Who?"
So ridiculous.
I couldn't... Sometimes I just have to
Sometimes the stories aren't as much funny as it's just like, really?
Yes. That's the point.
Really?
They're not always funny, but sometimes it's just you... I hold these people up as an example. I hold them up as an example to hopefully instill better behavior in some people.
Hopefully.
Hopefully.
Keyword hopefully.
Yeah. Not that I'm exactly a paragon of virtue here, but I would think at least if I'm going to take my child and hide her somewhere and report her missing to the police, I'm not going to send her to my boyfriend's house.
What a big dumb.
Even like the grandma's house or something.
So, anything. Almost literally anything.
Right.
Send her to camp. Oh, this was a good one.
Okay.
Oh, boy.
Goodness.
A South Carolina man applied for loans in order to buy meth.
I can't.
What makes this so funny is that I have to sit here while this song plays and Lunchbox just grins at us like, can you believe this?
I do have a little bit of a Cheshire grin going on with these things. I can feel it.
It's very funny.
Grady Indeed. Carson from Jonesville, South Carolina, applied for a loan at a company called Carolina Title Loans, Inc. Carolina Title Loans, Inc. is one of those short-term, high-interest payday loan companies where the interest rate a person has to pay back ranges from 96 to 362%, depending on the amount that the customer was planning on loaning.
Okay.
He asked to take out a loan in exchange for his vehicle. While the loan officer was filling out the necessary paperwork, Gary was uneasily pacing back and forth and then made the mistake of telling Jennifer, the loan officer, that he needed the money to buy meth. So he just flat out told her he was going to go buy meth with it. The loan officer, nervous after the exchange of words, faxed her manager, who was then located in another department, to come help her. She faxed her manager. I'm getting such a visual off this one.
Yeah.
When the police arrived at the title loan company, they searched and arrested Gary Carson. This is my favorite part of the story.
Oh, boy.
This is your favorite part?
There's always a buildup, you know.
Okay,
that.
Go ahead.
For sure.
Gary had a vial of crack in his pocket and stated that it was cocaine, but he had no intention of smoking it because he preferred meth.
Amazing. Amazing.
He was
God.
He was
I'm more of a meth man myself.
You got to appreciate like, a connoisseur.
Like a drug connoisseur.
Well, you know, I like the meth better because meth. Yeah.
That one killed me.
He was charged with possession of drugs and was taken to jail.
That one killed me. Oh my gosh, I'm more of a meth man myself.
More of a meth man.
That's so funny.
I find it smoother and has less of a come down. I don't like the tannins in crack.
I'm more of a red wine man. Like, oh my gosh, that's so funny. There was a moment that I feel like I have to address. I was looking out this way while you were reading the story, and I like jumped back, and Remus looked at me as if I was okay. I saw a hawk full-on tackle a raven out of midair.
Oh,
it really went from
bear
to bear.
Wow.
And I was like, because it was coming that way, and I was like, wait, what's happening? As I'm like trying to pay attention to the story, and I'm like, oh my God. Like, it was crazy. Nature's
you know,
wow.
One of the things I love about this studio
nature's beautiful.
Is we're Indeed. On the second floor and we have this beautiful view.
Yes.
I mean, it will be beautiful once they put the grass back, but the station where I'm interning right now, they have four studios. And
oh,
they're
yeah.
just small, dark boxes. There's no windows. They have dim lighting. I mean, the lighting is for you know mood, but whatever.
Sure.
You know, this is a nice open room.
Oh, yeah.
It's air conditioned. We got lots of space. We've got an Edmund Kula coming in here bringing me the news. We've got
so
many amenities
stuff.
In here.
So much
good stuff. But yeah, I thought I needed to address that because Remus.
Yeah,
for a second,
I really wanted to know
like,
what was happening.
Thank you.
Legitimately
I'm happy.
Was legitimately concerned because I actually like physically like jumped back as I saw it. Mother
right.
Nature is
now,
beautiful.
But was it a raven or was it a crow?
I couldn't tell you.
Probably a crow. I don't know if we have ravens.
I don't
here.
Think
I don't
we
know,
have ravens.
But my favorite way to like distinguish between a crow and a raven is that it's like. Is that, like, a really big bird? Then it's probably a crow. Is that a, like, holy hell, that is a big bird? Then it's a raven.
Oh, I thought ravens were smaller.
I'm pretty sure
are
ravens
they bigger?
Are bigger.
Okay. The only way I ever knew about it was the tail feathers are supposed to be shaped differently, but I never
oh,
figured
yeah,
that, out what
that
was.
As well. And their
all
beaks
I know,
are shaped differently,
all
too.
All I know
but.
Is that it got full-on linebacker tackled out of the
That's
air.
Amazing.
And it was sick. It was very cool to witness. Mother Nature is beautiful. Okay, moving on.
As you know, I promised you a B story, another B story.
Why? Why did you promise us this? Why?
I warned you days ago.
You did, and I blocked it from my memory on purpose.
Go.
A hive of 20,000 bees stuck to the outside of a silver Mitsubishi Outlander for 2 days because their queen happened to be trapped inside.
Here is the beehive, but where are all the bees? Hiding away where nobody sees.
What? You what would be the song?
You would be surprised how much garbage children's music and videos there are for toddlers or infants on YouTube.
Oh, I would not be surprised. I've seen
all
plenty.
These really awful songs.
That shark song is one of the most viewed things on YouTube ever.
And actually, I like the heavy metal one.
I wouldn't say that's trash. It's gotten really irritating from. Yeah. How much people have sung it now. But.
Let's see. Carol Howarth drove... So this was in the UK, by the way. She drove her car for 2 miles, apparently trying to get away from the swarm of bees, but apparently they somehow cornered her while she was driving her car.
You're not going anywhere, see?
So she drove it for 2 miles, but unfortunately more bees gathered and stuck onto the back of her vehicle. She parked it in the town center in the city where she was at when the National Park Ranger Tom Moses posted a video of the bees covering the portion of the back of her car on Facebook. This is the part that kind of gets me. The car was situated there for 2 days before somebody finally decided to try doing something about the bees on the back of this car. So this park ranger decided to try collecting the bees, but he put the bees in a cardboard box, and then the box flew open and the bees jumped out and covered the car again.
Oh my goodness.
So unfortunately nobody was able to find the queen after suspecting it was stuck somewhere on or in the car. So eventually then they had to have a actual professional bee collector come out and smoke all the bees and then collect them in a little hive and then take them out. I just love the fact that it sat there for 2 days and she's got this whole situation going on.
I'm so disturbed.
I love the flight of the bumblebees on a kazoo.
For those of you,
I would have loved that if you didn't initially introduce it to me with the last bee story.
A quick recap for those of you that didn't listen to the last episode. He gave us this horrible, horrible bee story last one that if you want to listen to it, go. Where can they find the YouTube link to?
You could just simply do a Google search. Yeah. You mean for the song?
No, I'm talking about the story.
Oh, the story.
In the last episode.
Funny enough, I put that story together the night before on Monday, and I got home Tuesday afternoon and found it on CNN.
That's really funny.
I think I got to scoop CNN on something.
But if you want to listen to us talk about it, just YouTube or Google.
Woman Bee Eyes.
Or you can YouTube Get This and listen to us talking about it.
Oh, that's an even better idea.
YouTube. Yeah.
Go do a Google search for...
I loved this whole conversation of Brandon just being like, hey, Justin, promote our YouTube. Promote the YouTube. Hey, you should talk about our YouTube.
You can say it yourself. You don't have to bludgeoning me.
No, it's okay. I just wanted to give some self-plugs. But
it
legitimately, I don't want to spoil the story, but also it was one of the most disturbing things.
It was fantastic.
Yeah, and I personally don't want to hear about it again in my life, so...
I felt completely and positively attacked, and I'm not comfortable with it, and it was really rude that you would even do that story with us, and that's really, really rude.
This is not some kind of ASMR thing. It's not a woman eating a pickle at us, which, by the way, bugged the hell out of LaTanya last semester.
What?
That just annoyed... Just the fact that someone was getting millions of views eating a pickle on camera. She couldn't believe people were making money off
that. It's wild, but it's a thing.
Well, we're going to take a break. This has been Get This on Griffin Radio. We are GR.
Woo.
I'm your host, DJ Lunchbox, with...
DJ Supremus.
And DJ B. Millie, that's me.
Don't forget to check us out on Facebook at our Griffin Radio 119 account. Our Instagram profile is Griffin Radio SD. And, of course, you can always hear us on the TuneIn app under the Griffin Radio channel. Shoot me an email at lunchboxthedj@gmail.com. And of course, as B. Millie mentioned, you can find us on YouTube. I gotta find out what my channel name is. I just know I know the video name. Well, I've had it forever. Look for Justin Hoffa, or just do a search for Breakfast of Imbeciles, or Get This. You'll find it. We'll figure this out.
Find it.
We'll be back in just a minute, guys. Meet you back here. Caught in the way that I stand.
From around the world, across the U.S., and right here in San Diego, bringing you news, sports, and weather, Griffin Radio, your CNN News affiliate.
Good afternoon. This is Edmund Kula from Griffin Radio with the latest news. One man is in custody and two others are on the run after police in Texas say the suspect kidnapped, tortured, and two men. Graphic detail of the disturbing attack came out in court Wednesday. When one of the suspects appeared before a judge, the victims say they were restrained, beaten, choked, and even forced to snort cocaine. A student at University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign died early Saturday morning after falling off a roof. University officials say 21-year-old Destiny Thomas was a chemistry major. She was reportedly visiting a friend when she fell. Authorities are still investigating, but they say incident is considered to be, quote, a tragic accident. Her funeral will be held in Chicago Friday morning. Officials say he was stopped by church ushers Wednesday night and later detained by police. No one was injured. News reports say he tried to bring two canisters inside, but it's still unclear why. Police describe him as a 37-year-old man from New Jersey who could be emotionally disturbed. The incident happened 2 days after a massive fire tore through Notre Dame Cathedral in Paris. Embattled Venezuelan President Nicolas Maduro has responded to the new sanctions the U.S. has imposed on Venezuela. U.S. National Security Advisor John Bolton announced the sanction Wednesday, mainly against the Central Bank of Venezuela. Treasury Secretary Steve Mnuchin said in a statement that sanctions are to prevent the bank, quote, from being used as a tool of an illegitimate Maduro regime. Little Evan Jurgensen spent 3 years fighting cancer at Children's Medical Center in Plano, Texas. Now, the 12-year-old is back at home and going to school, but he hasn't forgotten what it's looked like to be a sick kid spending holidays in a hospital, so Evan likes to do little things to put a smile on other faces. Recently, he collected donations for Easter baskets. And on Wednesday, he was able to deliver more than 30 baskets.
We have small little toys that they can play with and just different activities that they can do while they do it so they won't be bored.
The rescue mission to save trapped cave driver was a success. It took about an hour for the specially trained driver to reach and retrieve the British man. When he made it out of the cave, Josh Bridgley was evaluated by medical crews, but he wasn't taken to the hospital. He was exploring a cave with four other experienced drivers. They entered the cave Tuesday afternoon. When the group came out, they observed Bridgley was missing. They tried several times unsuccessfully to dive back in and find him, and then called 911. Several experienced drivers were brought from other states to help with the rescue. An interesting note, Bradley was involved in helping rescue the Thai soccer team trapped in a cave last year. Today's weather is going to be in mid-80s and sunny. Currently is 12:40. This is Edmund Kula from Griffin Radio CNN affiliate.
This has been Griffin Radio, your CNN News affiliate.
Welcome back to Get This on Griffin Radio. We are GR. I'm DJ Lunchbox with...
Emily, that's me.
I am not...
It's okay.
...working the
it's
buttons
okay.
today. I'm just... And who the hell are you?
I'm DJ Supremus.
Okay, and we got that out of the way.
It's okay.
Yes, I'll get your flash drive for you. I'll bring it in a minute.
People sorry have for lost days.
Sorry for the delay on the sound effect there, Edmund, for your SOT. That was my fault.
People have off days,
people
man.
People have off days.
We've been new. Today's my off day.
But why the hell not? We'll go with that.
Yeah.
So you've been listening to, well, just some news, frankly, and then you're going to be listening to some more weird news stories with us on Get This. Check us out on Facebook at Griffin Radio 119. Our Instagram account is Griffin Radio SD. And, of course, you can always hear us on the TuneIn app under the Griffin Radio channel. So we are back finally. You guys ready for a little bit more weird?
Yeah.
Strange.
I always am.
Seven stories.
Stories.
I feel like that last B story just kind of brought the two of you down, so maybe this one will get you a little bit better.
Yeah. Give me back hyped.
Police were called, and the TV reporter Jonathan Lowe was arrested after pooping on somebody's front yard.
Me now. Good. Having a good time.
Apparently he wasn't having a very good time, but so this was a local reporter in this area. The incident occurred outside of a home in Goodyear, Arizona, back in last year, May 16th. Jonathan Lowe was on duty as a field day reporter to report a story. Residents of the area noticed him and his news team as they were on scene with their parked news trucks for over 40 minutes. The reporter Jonathan was suspected to have felt an urge to go to the bathroom as he was seen gathering up newspapers from all over the road.
Oh, no.
After gathering enough material, he found a quiet spot, leaned up against the wall of a nearby home, squatted, and proceeded to do his business. All of which occurred as the resident of the property watched in horror.
That's so...
Once he'd finished his deed and cleaned himself up and walked back to his news van... the resident of the property was still in awe of what had just happened and decided to call 911 to report the incident. The police arrived and went to the news van to talk to Jonathan, and he knew exactly what the police wanted to talk to him about as they showed up.
Wow.
He reportedly said, "I've been feeling very sick, and I've been stuck in this van all day. So I went over to that person's yard and took care of business. Those people who called just want to start problems with me." So, yeah, they have just problems with you going and, you know, just defiling the side of their home.
You know,
don't go to the bathroom on my lawn, man. Super simple.
Indeed.
He was arrested for public defecation, and later that week, the station's news director reported he was no longer working for them.
Aww.
Bummer, man.
Bummer, dude.
Well, you know what they say. You don't poop where you work, so.
Good one. But a news director works everywhere. Everywhere is news. Does that mean they just never poop?
He was just a reporter. The news director sits in his little nest at home, disapproving of people, but
curmudgeonly.
So yeah, he just had to hike his trousers down right there and let go and let God.
I've always wondered, like, I've never felt the urge that bad, like so bad that I just have to find anything anywhere. Like, I don't think I've ever had to go to the bathroom that bad where it's like, if I don't go to the bathroom right now, like, it's just going to happen, so, like, I'm just going to go anywhere I can find. I've never had that.
But even in that situation, it's still, like, clearly he was in a residential area. Why don't you just go up to someone's door and knock and go, "Hey, sorry to bother you. Would you mind if I use your restroom?"
Yes. Even if that didn't work out, that wasn't an option, the fact that he had been gathering up newspaper apparently in the street. Okay,
you know what?
Never mind. I don't want to analyze that too much because I don't want to start getting into the logistics and different positions and how we could like throw his ankle over the headrest.
I do agree with you because like that is probably the logical scenario. But like if some random guy just came up to me and said, "Hey, can I use your bathroom?" I'd probably be like, "No."
Okay, but he's in like a suit probably and there is a news van. Like,
yeah, the residents said they'd seen like, him and his crew in the neighborhood for a while.
Yeah, that's different. That's different, yeah. You're right.
If it was a rando, then...
A rando.
It'd be like, I don't know about that, but...
Get out of here.
Ew, it's so gross. Now the guy's got to get his house repainted. Maybe sandblasted.
Has to move, probably. He's just like, I'm going to move.
He's never going to look at that wall the same.
Yeah, no,
I'm just
going to
move now.
I would just move at that point.
Just looks at his shit out back. Oh, yeah, that's where that reporter took a dump. Oof. Memories. A West Virginian woman punched her son after receiving the wrong toppings on her burrito.
Don't disappoint me. Don't let me down.
I've heard it all before. I just want something more. If it's not with okay. Replaying this in my head, I now see that that makes sense. But what I thought was originally like the people at the store put the wrong toppings on. Like in the drive-thru, and she was so mad and figured, I can't punch him, but I can punch him. Not that,
oh
like, he.
God.
I assume he ordered her food and got her order
wrong. Well, you
gotta
let me read the story.
I'm sorry.
We're not playing Remus's game.
I know. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
I got to give you the facts.
The facts.
The facts of
Loretta
life.
Armstrong from Milton, West Virginia, had requested that her son go to Taco Bell and get burritos. Her 15-year-old son went to the store and ordered the wrong toppings for his mom's burrito. When he came home with it, his mother was not pleased. A loud argument erupted from inside the house and police were contacted. When they arrived, the mother was punching her child in the face. They tried to intervene and arrested her, but she threw herself to the ground and complained of chest pains and then began to rant at the top of her voice, screaming and yelling that she was having a heart attack. The police contacted emergency crews who performed an EKG, which checks for electrical activity in your heart, and concluded that she was not, in fact, having a heart attack. It took the police 3 hours to arrest this woman. She was charged with felony child abuse and misdemeanor counts of obstruction, intimidating a police public official, and disorderly conduct. The police report stated they were not able to handle her due to her behavior, so they decided to just send her straight to jail with a $31,000 bail.
God.
Yep, that's... Yeah.
Over Taco Bell? It isn't even that good.
Right.
You have to get good Taco Bell, and then you know.
I was also going to say, we're very spoiled here in San Diego with good Mexican food.
That's true, we are.
Hey, freaking men to that.
I was going to say, yeah.
Now, I mean, just the options alone, good options for.
Oh, yeah.
I'm not going to say Mexican food, but I'll say proximate. Like, we had Chipotle at lunch yesterday up at where I was doing the intern.
Yeah.
And even catered Chipotle that I have to assemble myself in the little bowls that they brought us is still damn good with that guacamole.
And it's like, we're in San Diego, I could drive 5 minutes and hit like 8 different Mexican food shops, all of which are damn good.
True. And as I was pointing out last night when we were done shooting, there's a heck ton of 24/7 Mexican food places that are also damn good.
Mm-hmm.
So like literally any time of day we want Mexican food, we can just go get it.
So we're getting lunch after this, right, guys?
Oh, God.
I wish.
good guacamole just makes me so happy. Yeah, I could leave my house and head in any one of the 4 cardinal compass directions and find a good Mexican place.
Oh, yeah.
I could name them near my place.
And don't you love people that have never, like, come out here and then they come to visit and they're like, oh, what's your Mexican food like? It's like... Get ready for a ride.
Better than yours, I can tell you that
much.
Get
ready for a ride, you idiot.
Just sit back, grab a hold of something.
It's like Aladdin and Jack. I can show you the world.
I've had someone from New Mexico argue with me that their Mexican food is better than ours, and I was like, just
because
Mexico is in the name of your state does not make it better.
The only place Mexican food is better than California is in Mexico.
Yep.
A freaking men. You do not put mayonnaise in guacamole, I'm just saying.
Ugh.
No.
Ooh, I didn't want to know that was a thing that happened
ever.
Anyway.
Oh, I think I might have brought this up last semester or the semester before. I was watching Barefoot Contessa, you know, Ina Garten, the cooking maven.
Okay. Yeah.
I think I know what you're bringing up, but continue.
So she was making guacamole, and so she started to bring out all of these ingredients, and none of them, except for the avocado and salt, had anything to do with guacamole. It offended me.
Ugh.
She starts throwing in gherkins, like chopped gherkins, and then she starts throwing in some Tabasco sauce, sriracha. She's like starts throwing in all this stuff, and I turn to my man, and he can just see like the vein in my temple throbbing. No. I waited till he got home, and I was like tapping my foot, like, you wouldn't believe what Ina was doing today. And so I told him all about it, and he was just like, that's not guacamole, it's avocado spread. Anyway.
Again, I'm no Mexican cuisine connoisseur, but there are certain things that you do not step on.
Oh, absolutely.
If you screw up my carne asada fries, I may I may write a report to the President of the United States.
I feel it.
Just like,
feel it.
Who are you and why are you doing this?
So I'm going to file a report.
My God.
A Domino's delivery driver who was wearing a crash helmet headbutted a customer over an argument about pizza toppings.
I love the continual, like, aggressive food story.
I was gonna say I'm glad that we stuck with the food theme.
Yeah.
It just came. Food. I don't know why, but it just
tell us them deets.
Yeah.
Yes, please.
The victim of the incident, Paul Williams, posted a picture to Domino's Facebook page of his bruised forehead, explaining he was attacked by a delivery driver after an argument over missing toppings on his pizza. Mm. The angry delivery driver, who is suspected to be a manager, rode to the man's house wearing a crash helmet on Friday the 13th.
The delivery
driver knocked on his door. When he opened the door, the delivery driver slash manager strangled him and then headbutted him with his crash helmet and then stomped on his head when he was on the ground.
Oh my goodness.
During the incident, police were called to the scene. When they arrived, they were met by the delivery driver, who was brandishing an air rifle at them, which he used to shoot at the police before being subdued and arrested. What is it with this crappy food places where people just lose their minds?
I'm surprised that man isn't dead. You don't even get to point like toy guns at officers nowadays without them like taking every precaution necessary.
I know, an air rifle.
I don't know where this was. I can only assume it was in one of the kind of gun happy states.
There's a lot of air rifles that don't have the like
the safety tips
on them.
Yeah, the peace bonding or whatever it's called.
Yeah.
So like they look freaking real.
So, and not to detract from the importance of this story, but Chicago style or New York style pizza?
New York.
I can't eat pizza, so I can't even remember.
Because I'm a Chicago guy.
I like a lot of crust.
New York pizza is basically what you would think of as pizza. You know, just like here's the pizza. It's got its like crust. It's cut up into slices. Chicago style seats pizza is deep dish pizza.
It's basically like a pie.
It's more of like a pie than it is like a slice of pizza that you would get.
Yeah, I don't like that.
And also, I am no fool. In the same vein that we have the best Mexican food, New York and Chicago have the best pizza. We don't know what real pizza tastes
like.
And New York's got the best bagels.
Don't forget Italy.
Well, but Italy is collectively offended by what we consider pizza.
Yeah.
But I've had pizza in Italy, and like, it's basically just our pizza, but better and with less weird toppings.
Yeah, there you go.
Like,
it's just better.
They're offended because we put some weird stuff on it.
Well, okay. I mean, I will publicly and proudly declare and come out
right now and say that
I love pineapple and pepperoni.
I was going to say, are you going to say Hawaiian pizza? Because I used to love Hawaiian pizza.
Okay, I don't care for the ham. I like the pepperoni because it gets a little more spicy, a little sweet and spicy
action. Ooh, still, the pineapple on pizza thing.
Yes.
I'm not a pineapple person, period. Mm. You like all those peas?
Yes.
I'm not a pineapple person, period.
You know me. I love alliteration.
Alliteration, yes. So I'm not a pineapple person on my pizza anyways. So,
okay.
But I'm glad that we addressed this. I'm sorry to retract from that, but I'm glad that we addressed the Chicago versus New York, because there are some, in my opinion, because again, we don't have the best pizza in the world. We got to address that. Mm. But there are some pretty good deep dish pizza places around. I'll have to hit you up and tell you where it was eventually.
If you know any gluten-free ones, let me know.
I will let you know. I believe they had a gluten-free option.
Interesting. Before it was gluten-free, though, I will say thin crust has always been my favorite, but deep dish I prefer over New York.
Okay.
Well, I'm glad we got that settled. I have no problem with deep dish pizza. I just don't care for it.
I'm more of a flatbread
kind of person.
Not to change away from the important.
Thin crust.
Yeah, exactly. A man has been arrested. God, some people I just don't understand. You all right there?
I'm fine. I just forgot I put my USB on top of my phone.
You know what? We're just all having that kind of day here. A man has been arrested after teaching his girlfriend's pug a Nazi salute as a prank and has now been arrested for being racist.
Springtime for Hitler and Germany.
Thank you for using this song.
It's kind of astounding to me how many stories I've come across that sort of call for this song. This is like the third or the fourth time I've used it.
This is true.
Marcus Meechan from Scotland released a video on YouTube of him training his girlfriend's dog named Buddha to perform a Nazi salute when he says the words Sieg Heil. His intention for the video was to prank his girlfriend, who believed her dog was cute, so he decided to teach the dog the Nazi salute, as that would turn Buddha into, quote, the least cute thing you could think of, which is a Nazi. The YouTube video consists of him repeatedly asking the pug, "Do I gas Jews?" and the dog making a startled expression toward the camera.
Gosh.
The dog performs a number of Nazi salutes to the words Sieg Heil, and there is a clip of Hitler delivering a speech with the pug avidly watching. At the end of the video, he makes the announcement, "By the way, I'm not racist. I just really wanted to piss my girlfriend off." He has since apologized for his actions after his arrest, saying, "I'm so sorry to the Jewish community for any offense I have caused them. This was never my intention, and I apologize." The video was titled, "Mate, Your Doug's a Nazi," and was released on the YouTube channel Count Dankula. So this guy sounds like a real catch. I bet he is
sounds
just...
like a meme king, honestly.
His picture, basically, if you imagine what Post Malone looks like,
uh-huh,
and take away the money, that was this guy.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
There you go.
He just sounds like a joy, just a gas to
super
be around 24/7.
Cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, going to take a hard pass.
Going to take a hard pass. Going
to take
that
a hard, hard pass
hard
on ever
no.
hanging out with this guy or talking to this guy. Just I'm going to pass.
Okay, but my big question, or my big question at first, when I like didn't realize it was like in Scotland, I was like, how does someone get arrested for being racist? Because, like, you know, people here are racist all the time, but it's in Scotland, so, I mean, I guess
yeah, I mean,
it's
Germany, it's completely, it's like a felony to promote any kind of Nazi
ideal
whatsoever. So, yeah. I just imagine this girl, after living with him for however long they've been together, just every day she comes home.
Like.
What have you done now?
Yeah.
What have you done?
Like. How are you that? How do you have that much time on your hands? You don't have anything else to do but to train a dog to respond to Nazi salutes. Like,
there are other ways to make dogs not cute. Just saying.
Yeah. Well, he had plenty of time to get tattoos on his neck too. So this guy's a real winner. Just such a catch.
I liked that. That was it. What was that? Was that a B-52 starting?
And last story for today, a Connecticut man grew tired of waiting and fired a shot into a bathroom because the person inside was just taking too long.
I can't wait forever, darling. I can't wait forever, but I want to.
Amazing.
I cracked myself up.
Good.
Sean Cummins was staying at an apartment in Connecticut when police were called to the scene after reports of a gun being fired inside the apartment building.
You're doing your show with two very tall children. You're doing your show with two very tall children.
No,
literally,
me
and Remus looked at each other. Literally in a second, I was just like, Cummins?
No, I know exactly what you're...
Oh, I was already... Yep.
I had a brief but furious debate with myself last night over whether to make a joke about
Okay, I'm sorry. Continue.
When the police arrived at the scene, they found a highly intoxicated Mr. Cummins at the scene.
Now I can't not.
Sorry.
Now I can't not. I'm sorry.
I'll just say Mr. C. How's that?
Okay, go ahead.
Call him
better.
Sean.
That's
go
better.
Ahead.
They found an entire and highly intoxicated Sean at the scene. Through some investigation, the police found out that he had gone over to a friend's house in a nearby apartment to hang out. He became upset when a person in the bathroom in the apartment wouldn't get out, and he needed to use the bathroom. So he whipped out his 9mm and fired a shot into the bathroom, and it's reported the bullet just missed the occupant. He then went on to fire a second shot, but this one toward the outside wall of the apartment. The police arrested and charged Sean with unlawful discharge of a firearm, carrying a firearm while intoxicated, reckless endangerment, threatening, and disorderly conduct. The police also seized a 12-gauge shotgun and a 45 caliber handgun. Cummins. I mean, come on.
Thank you for ending with that.
You're so welcome.
That's, oh, my gosh.
Yeah.
It was just so much more funny when, like, me and Remus both looked at each other, and I was like, bro. And he was like, I know.
<It's> I know. Cummins. I can't believe it either. Oh, yeah. Man. So that takes us to the end of this.
That was a good way to end it.
Yeah.
No, it was a fantastic.
Good luck, Sean.
On a good little second grade giggle. Thank you so much for listening. This has been Get This on Griffin Radio. We are GR. I'm your host, DJ Lunchbox.
With DJ Supremus.
And DJ B. Millie, that's me.
We will be back next Tuesday, again, every Tuesday and Thursday from noon to 1 on Griffin Radio. Check us out on Griffin Radio 119 on Facebook. Our Instagram is Griffin Radio SD. And, of course, you can always hear us on the TuneIn channel, TuneIn app under the Griffin Radio channel. Shoot me an email at lunchboxthedj@gmail.com and check us out on YouTube. Thank you so much for listening, guys. We will see you next week. To be honest, that platonic TV show.